Hey guys, what's up? As some of y'all may remember, at the end of a previous video I did about Proto-Indo-European mobile S and laryngeals, I asked if there were any other PIE concepts that needed an in-depth explanation like that, and one answer definitely stood out in the comments, Ablaut. So yeah, this right here is the highly anticipated video explaining PIE Ablaut. To eliminate any confusion now, this video isn't specifically about Germanic languages. It is true that the term Ablaut is also used for the irregular past tense verbs in Germanic languages, and that is a part of Ablaut, but it goes all the way back to PIE, and that deep origin is what we're focusing on. Also, we're not talking about umlaut here either. That's a completely different thing that only applies to Germanic languages. So yeah, let's go! So first off, what exactly was Ablaut? Basically, it was a system in Proto-Indo-European where a vowel could be e, o, or nothing, depending on where the stress was in the word, kinda. And it would also get lengthened if it was in the last syllable of a word with a sonorant after it and no additional suffix. The vowel found in a particular syllable is known to linguists as its grade. It'll probably be easiest to think about it as an allophonic system somewhat like vowel reduction, and in fact, while Ablaut certainly wasn't allophonic in PIE, it probably had been at some point earlier. One egregiously over-exemplified pattern in Ablaut basically goes A if it's stressed, 0 if it's before the stress, and O if it's after the stress. The Wikipedia page on Ablaut gives this table to show examples of this, but keep in mind the writers do correctly concede that this word is particularly well-behaved in both PIE and ancient Greek. Normally it's not that clean with Ablaut because like you could have stressed 0 grades, stressed O grades, post-stress 0 grades, unstressed A grades, you get the point. But so like, are those all the vowels in PIE? Well yeah, kind of. Something important to understand is that PIE also had E and U vowels, but they weren't phonemic. They were allophones of the liquid consonants Y and W respectively that occurred when between consonants. And yes, this was a true allophone in actual PIE, unlike Ablaut itself. So for example, there were PIE adjectives like grohnis, which probably meant plant-colored, and grechus, a word for heavy, both masculine nominative. For those words, we would say the suffix has a zero grade. It becomes more apparent in certain other forms of the adjectives, like the masculine genitive forms grhnes and grcheus, where the suffixes are now stressed and in the A grade. Simon Roper also mentioned this in a video, but yeah, the whole I and U thing in PIE is purely academic. If the PIE speakers had their own writing system, those words would most likely be spelled grohnis and grechus to represent their phonemic values, making them syllabic consonants no different from rrr. But now, like I find useful in these types of videos, I want to show some parallels to PIE Ablaut, this time using modern examples. The main example I can give starts with the English preposition for, which has o as the lone vowel. But then let's make it an unstressed prefix on a longer word like forget. We may call this the zero grade as there's a syllabic er there, but then let's add a suffix onto this word giving us forgetful. Now realistically in my dialect this L is also a syllabic consonant, but in some other dialects it may have kind of an O vowel there. Of course, since this is American English pronunciation, this is actually based on the allophone back vowels take before liquids, but for the sake of demonstration, let's say that the O grade is present in the suffix. That would make this word fit rather well with the overgeneralized PIE Ablaut pattern. Except that there was no F sound in PIE, the R's were most likely trilled and it's hard to tell how dark the L would be, so... Brgedpol? That looks hilarious, oh my god. But yeah, it's that general pattern basically. Speaking of the back vowels before liquids allophone, other versions of that where the L disappears completely are a decent way to look at W becoming U. While some dialects, like mine, would have syllabic L in words like circle, others like AVE and much of England, including Simon Roper's dialect, he uses this example too, pronounce it with a back vowel. That's the basic idea, except that the PIE phoneme was W, with the same logic also applied to Y. So now we'll get into how Ablaut affected the modern Indo-European languages, and I'll start with probably the most straightforward example there is. Present tense conjugations of the verb be. In several Indo-European languages, there's an interesting dichotomy where the verb conjugation for he, she, it, is has an S sound at or near the end of the word, or it was there historically, while for they are, the S sound is at the beginning of the word. By the way, English R doesn't count for this, in case it seemed like I implied that. But yeah, this pattern is most widespread in the Romance languages, where you have like Spanish es en son, Portuguese e en son, French e en son, Italian e en sono, and Romanian este en sunt, all of which come from Latin est en sunt. But the arrangement can also be found scattered in other Indo-European languages like German ist und sind, Polish jest und sind, and even Sanskrit asti and santi. The origin of all these verb forms is, of course, Proto-Indo-European, but how did these two conjugations come from the same verb when they look so different from each other? This is Ablaut. Basically, here's the conjugation chart for the verb meaning be in PIE for the present tense. As you can see, the stress is different in different conjugations. This led to a coinciding difference in the vowels on a stressed syllable, meaning that he, she, it, is in PIE was hesti, but they are in PIE was senti. The plural form's stress suffix changed the root from an A grade to a zero grade, i.e. the vowel disappeared. For the plural form, by the way, the laryngeal, of course, dropped off, which is why all the aforementioned forms have an S sound at the beginning. And, knowing what we know about laryngeals, when they were at the beginning of the word before another consonant, ancient Greek added a vowel between them, which means that ancient Greek esti and esi are also part of this pattern. Fun stuff. In some situations, the differing case or derivational forms of PIE words can result in Ablaut differences in descendant languages. The best example of this I know of is the word foot and its cognates. It descends from the PIE word Bots, which had an inflection table looking like this. The English word foot itself is descended straight from the nominative form, which was lengthened O grade, and it stayed like that up through the present. However, a lot of the other cases have the root in the A grade, as well as some derivational forms, which makes for an interesting set of descendant words. By the way, the zero grade is irrelevant here, as PD wasn't a legal word initial cluster in PIE. As far as Germanic languages go, the only example of an A grade descendant of this word I could find that isn't completely obsolete is Fetter, which apparently refers to shackles that go near people's feet. It comes from Proto-Germanic Fetteros, which comes from the PIE word Pedros. I very much feel like the first syllable would be a zero grade if one of the consonants was either a liquid or laryngeal. But things get more interesting when we widen our knowledge to Latin and Greek. In Latin, for example, the word was bis, with the genitive form pedis, both A grade. Meanwhile, in ancient Greek, they used the O grade, so their word for foot was bous, genitive form polos, which has now become poli in modern Greek. Also, notice how both the above nominative forms lost the D sound and compensatorily lengthened the preceding vowel. But yeah, throughout most of the European languages, morphemes referring to feet come from one of these two languages, and their main difference is Ablaut. For example, words like pedal, pedestrian, and centipede have E's in them and come from Latin, while other words like arthropod, octopus, and podiatrist have O's in them, or U in the case of octopus, and they're of Greek origin. So now for the final point, something a lot of y'all are probably wondering, how exactly did the PIE Ablaut system result in the situation with Germanic past tense verbs? Well, the first thing to know is that the Germanic past tense isn't descended from the PIE past tense. That looked like this, but you know the verb system in Slavic languages where there are different lexical verbs for different aspects? Yeah, this was inherited directly from PIE, it wasn't an innovation. The PIE aspect system had three main aspects, imperfective, describing ongoing actions, perfective, describing completed actions, and stative, which described, you know, states, where the verb is just describing dynamics, and all three of these aspects had different conjugational suffixes associated with them. For our purposes here, we care about the imperfective and stative aspects because the stative is what would eventually become the Germanic past tense. In PIE, the stative was, for the most part, formed off the imperfective by reduplicating the first consonant and putting an epenthetic A there. This change would be accompanied by the original A vowel in the root switching to O. For two examples, there was the PIE imperfective verb for probably come, guemeti, which became guegwome in the stative, and there was also the PIE imperfective verb meaning turn, wirti, which became wewurte in the stative. And since now you've seen those, you probably know where I'm going from here. The imperfective became the Germanic present, and the stative became the Germanic past. Using our two examples from above, guemeti became Proto-Germanic guemanon, because Proto-Germanic innovated in infinitive form, while its past tense form for third person singular was kwam. And this led to English come versus came, Dutch komma versus kwam, and Swedish komma versus kom, among other languages. For the other one, PIE wirti became Proto-Germanic wirthanon, meaning become, and its past tense form was warth. For both examples, they followed the regular o to a shift that happened in pre-Germanic. This latter verb led to Dutch worde versus werd and German werden versus wat, which is now archaic and has been replaced by wurde. So that's it! But also as a complete side note here, if you happen to write on Wiktionary that the Germanic g prefix on past participles comes from PIE kjom, I'd like to present an alternative hypothesis based on PIE stative verbs. I feel like instead the g prefix is based on a common PIE verb starting with g or gje, probably gjeti meaning go, and its stative prefix just got extended to other verbs. This hypothesis has the advantage that it actually follows Grimm's Law. Also, if you left a comment on the video about Germanic grammatical evolution asking me the origin of the g prefix, I have a new answer for you. So there we have it, that's my explanation of Ablaut. I'm sure there's a lot more in-depth stuff about Ablaut that other linguists know, but hopefully this is at least good enough to help y'all learn the basics of what it was and what it did. Realistically, I probably learned just as much about Ablaut by doing this video as y'all did by watching it, and y'all still have the option to write more tough concepts in the comments, which I may or may not make a video about in the future, just like happened with this one. Also, like and subscribe for more. Thanks for watching!